Good morning and welcome to worship. It's great to have you with us here online. As we begin worship today, I'm thinking about a church tradition that teaches that St. Thomas, you know St. Thomas, the one who was called Doubting Thomas, well, he became a bold witness for Jesus in the early church after the resurrection of Jesus Christ and Christ's appearances to him. And tradition teaches us that he went out into the world to India and established the church in India. And there is a religious community that is a group of Jesus followers there called the Malabar community. And it stretches back to the 5th century for sure, and probably earlier that we know of. And that community has a wonderful prayer that is a liturgical tradition within their midst. And I've adapted it and adopted it for our call to worship this day. And I'd like you to read the part in bold and share together this prayer as we enter into worship today. Grant us, Lord Jesus, that our ears will hear truth and be closed to the voice of dispute. Grant us, O Lord Jesus, that our eyes, which have seen your great love, may also behold your blessed hope. Grant us, O Lord Jesus, that our tongues that declare your praise may speak the truth in love. Grant us, O Lord Jesus, that our feet that take us places may walk in the region of light. Grant, O Lord Jesus, that the bodies that we have received from you will be the living body of Christ in the world, restoring newness of life. Glory to you, O Lord Jesus. Glory to you for your inexpressible gifts. Amen.
Thank you. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, goodness, and love, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, who for us in our salvation lived and died and rose again and lives evermore, and in the Holy Spirit, who takes the things of Christ and reveals them to us, renewing, comforting, and inspiring our souls. We are united in striving to know the will of God as taught in the Holy Scriptures, and in our purpose to walk in the ways of the Lord, made known or to be made known to us. Amen.
Oh.
God is our strength and our shield. God is our protector and our provider. What a wonderful thing it is to believe and trust in a God who loves us and to belong to a faith community like ours. Let us respond today to God's bounty in our life by presenting our gifts for the work of God's church here in this place. And I pray that you would just feel comfortable today to go online to redlands.church and provide an online gift, or write out a check and send it here to First Congregational Church this week. Thank you for the way that you give and you uphold the ministry of this congregation and the way that we serve throughout this community and around the world. Would you pray together with me as we dedicate our gifts to God? Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we offer these monetary gifts for your mission and your ministry in the world, as well as for this congregation and our fellowship life together. In our giving, may we be so blessed with a sure knowledge that we're making a difference and have this great confidence that we ourselves have enough because we have you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'll put you in front of my melody. You are all that matters, you are all that matters. I'll make room for two, you and I, Jesus. You are all that matters, you are all that matters. Away, away, you are all that matters. Away, away, you are all that matters. Away, away, you are all that matters. Away, away. What would I live for if I don't have you in my life? What would I gain if you take the Holy Ghost? What would have become of me if I didn't see your light? What would have been said of me if you didn't hold my hands? Now I've come to realize that you are all I have. You are all that matters. You are all that matters. I'll put you in front of my melody. You are all that matters. You are all that matters. I'll make room for two, you and I, Jesus. You are all that matters. You are all that matters. Is it the car or is it the house? I'll give them all to you. Is it the name or is it the fame? I'm nothing without you. What would have become of me if I didn't see your light? What would have been said of me if you didn't hold my hands. Now I've come to realize that you are all I have. You are all that matters. You are all that matters. I'll put you in front of my melody. You are all that matters. You are all that matters. I'll make room for two. You and I, Jesus, you are all that matters. You are all that matters. Way, oh, way, you are all that matters. Oh, way, you are all that matters. Oh, way, you are all that matters. Oh, way, you are all that matters.
Please listen to the Word of God. Today we're going to read from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 through chapter 3, verse 12. Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain from fleshly lusts, which wage war against the soul. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing that in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, on account of your good deeds, as they observe them, glorify God in the day of his visitation. Submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every human institution, as to a king, as the one in authority, or as governors, as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right, you may silence the ignorance of foolish man. Act as free men, and do not use your freedom as a covering for evil, but use it as the bond slaves of God. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. For this finds favor, if for the sake of conscience towards God, a man bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. For what credit is there if, when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you as an example for you to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed. For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. In the same way, you wives, Be submissive to your husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives. As they observe your chaste and respectful behavior. And let not your adornment be merely external, braiding the hair, wearing gold jewelry, or putting on dresses, but let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. For in this way, in former times, the holy women also, who hoped in God, used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their husbands. Thus Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you have become her children if you do what is right without being frightened by any fear. Now you husbands, likewise, live with your wives in an understanding way, as with a weaker vessel, since she is a woman, and grant her honor as a fellow heir in the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. To sum up, let all be harmonious, sympathetic, brotherly, kind-hearted, and humble in spirit. Not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead. For you were called for the very purpose that you might inherit a blessing. For let him who means to love life and see good days refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking guile. And let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you so much. And I tell you, I was trying to think of that song when I was teaching those kids. I had so many other tunes in my brain, I couldn't think of it. And one of the tunes I had in my brain was that fabulous song the choir sang. I heard it in the earlier service from the quartet. I love that song. Cindy, remember when we first heard that song? Ken Miedema wrote it, and he came to our high school that Cindy and I attended in Hawaii. And Ken Miedema wrote that song. Ken is also blind. And I was the president of our student body, and I had the responsibility back then to introduce guests that came to our school. And I also introduced him, but also I took him to the airport because he couldn't drive himself. And over the years, I've seen him in many different settings, and I so much appreciate that song. I love it. One of the things about growing up in Hawaii is that I was only there 3 years, but I picked up a wife there. And I tell you, I'm so glad my wife is not from Iowa. I have a friend who has a wife from Iowa. They go back every year. It's his family obligation. Me, I take my wife to Hawaii. I just have to do it. It's my responsibility. One of the things I love to do when we're in Hawaii is I love to snorkel. Any of you like to snorkel? Oh, it's so much fun. And I love to put on the fins and swim together with the fish. I love to put on the mask and be down there with the fish and see all the colors and the beauty of the coral. I love to have that snorkel on where I can just keep breathing and being in the sea without coming up for any air. I feel at one with the sea. I feel kind of like a sea creature myself. And I was in Hawaii this last time we were there, and I was out snorkeling, and I saw one of the most beautiful sights. It was a huge, beautiful sea turtle. I love sea turtles. And so I followed it around and about in and out of the coral. I went around and into some foggy water and then back out of it. And then on one occasion, I found myself completely surrounded by murky water. And all of a sudden, a thought came to my mind. I remembered hearing somewhere that sharks like sea turtles. But they like them in a different way than I like them. And I also remember hearing that more shark attacks oftentimes occur in murky water. And you're supposed to avoid that. So with this instant recollection, I just hightailed it out of there. And I get to some clear water and I take off the mask and I look up at the world around me, this beautiful blue ocean. I gazed up at the sky, the cotton candy clouds so fluffy and white. I looked at the cliffs on the side of the shore with their waterfalls coming down from the cliffs, looking as if God had sculpted them with God's very hands. And I thought to myself, what an amazingly beautiful world. And I also looked down at the water and I said, and it's also dangerous. It seems to me that Peter has a similar message in our text for today. He wants us to know that this world is beautiful, and yet there's dangers. And he shares with us a message to help us avoid some of the dangers that we might experience. How is it that we can live as fully alive, vital Christians in the midst of this world with dangers? And he breaks it down for us to talk about how do we live in a vital way within the realm of our public life with all of its dangers, and how do we live in the realm of our private life with all of the challenges that are there. We can find ourselves in murky water in both places. Now, first of all, he begins with this description of our public life. And if you look in your Bibles, look at chapter 2, beginning in verse 13, he describes for us what the responsibility of a citizen in the country is to be. We're supposed to submit, be subject to the authorities over us. And if you would, look at verse 14. Do you see it in your text? In verse 14, Peter says that we who have these governors over us, these governors have the responsibility for punishing who? What does it say? Evildoers, right. And rulers with authority are also supposed to offer praise to who? Those who do right. Now, here's a question. Does anybody know a government that always appropriately punishes those who do evil? And does anybody know a government that always appropriately brings honor and reward for those who do right? Certainly, there are systems and governments and countries that get dimensions right, but there is no perfect union. I was reading a book recently by the scholar Karen Armstrong, and in her book, Fields of Blood, she makes this argument that civilization itself, because it's made up of people, civilization itself is entwined with violence. And she goes on to argue that treachery, coercion, violence, intrigue, manipulations, war is a part of the warp and woofle, the woof of everything that makes up our culture. And as she makes this argument, I must kind of agree. Several years ago, Cindy and I were in Europe for the summer, and we did a pastor exchange in Scotland. And as kind of a study project while we were in Scotland, I read about all the kings and queens of England. I tell you, there are some bloody kings in England, literally. So many people have blood on their hands. And yet, the message for us in Scripture is that we are to nevertheless realize kings, leaders, authorities, governments have responsibility. And in our text, it says, this is what we are to do in verse 17. Look at it with me. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Bible scholars call this a Hebrew chiasm. And chiasms are forms of poetry that start with broad thoughts and then narrow them down, and they're oftentimes in couplets. So God made you, not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. And here you have another kind of chiasm like that. And Peter is telling us, you know, there are some broad concepts, you know, to fear God. And how do you recognize a fear of God? Well, show it by honoring the king. We're supposed to honor all people, but how do you show it? Well, live in brotherhood with one another and live in loving ways. And so as we are told by Peter to do all these things, he then tells us some very specific ways that we as Christians ought to live in relationship with the public life that is not always perfect. In fact, many of us experience sharks all around us. But Peter's advice, you don't become one yourself. And how is it that we avoid this? Well, the first thing is he tells us to beware that no leader is the master over our soul. Look down, if you would, at the text at the very bottom of the second chapter, I should say, and we're told that God, our Lord, is the guardian and shepherd of our soul. What Peter wants us to know is that no government, no authority, not a titan of industry, no boss, no individual can be the guardian and master of our soul, because we have a good shepherd who is responsible for us. And we should realize that as we come to this good shepherd who is the guardian of our soul, that we embrace him above all else. Now, one of the things that Peter understood is that he was called by Jesus to be a leader himself. And yet he knew that he was broken, because in the most crucial hour when Jesus was crucified, Peter had denied Jesus 3 different times. And yet Jesus, the resurrected Lord, appeared to Peter after the resurrection. And he came to Peter and he said, Peter, do you love me? And Peter responded, yes, I love you. And Jesus said, well, feed my sheep. But Peter was asked a second time by the Lord, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, you know I love you. And Jesus said, well, feed my sheep. And then a third time, Jesus said to Peter, Peter, do you really love me? And he goes, yes, at this point, incredulous. You know I love you. And Jesus said, then take care of my little lambs. And for Peter, this became the model for what leadership is all about. We receive love from our Lord, and we live in the confidence of that love, and then at the same time, we turn around and we share grace to those around us. That's the essence of any kind of leadership, great or small. You know, this is the kind of leadership that we sing about at Christmas time. You ever sing that song? Let's see if I can get it right. Good King Wenceslas. Da, 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 da. Oh, I can't get that one either. But I know what the story is about. It's about good King Wenceslas, who lived with all the treachery and evil around him. And listen, I tell you, I was just in Prague. I heard lots of stories about this guy. Wenceslas had treachery, murder. His mother was a murderer. His brother was a murderer. All around him was treachery. And yet, he decided to buck the system, care for the poor and the needs of others, and he became a saint, patron saint in Czechoslovakia. It's the kind of leadership that Peter is really calling us to, a kind of leadership that recognizes we have a need from the Lord, and we need to receive that love and grace and security from our good guardian and shepherd of our soul. Only He owns our soul. And then we demonstrate that confident love to others around us. Now, in addition to this kind of attitude, and quite frankly, it's the very attitude that Jesus had himself. Jesus had a confidence of being in relationship with the Heavenly Father. And then from that place of confidence, he could experience cruelty in the world. And listen, the people that were experiencing cruelty in the early church were experiencing the same kind of governmental oppression that Jesus himself had experienced. And Peter is reminding them, be like Jesus. Because when you're like Jesus, then you are suffering together with Jesus, and he is suffering together with you. Now, a second point that Peter is making for us about this life of living in the public, in the midst of the imperfections of public life, is that not only are we to be opening ourselves up to the reality of God in our life, but we also need to be understanding that we are a witness to those around us. Look at verse 11 in chapter 2. It says, keep your behavior excellent because others will observe you. Do we really realize that others are observing us as we're out and about responding and making decisions and interacting with the world around us? I was at the bank several years ago, and when I went into the bank, the lady at the counter said, I notice you're depositing checks from this church. I said, yes. She said, why are you getting these checks from this church? I said, I'm the pastor there. She said, oh, do you know old so-and-so? And I said, yes, I do. Did you know he's a pastor? And I said, yes, I do. And she said, you know, he's the meanest, grumpiest guy I've ever known. He comes into this bank and I run every time I see him. I go into the back room. I can't even believe he's a Christian, and yet he calls himself a pastor. I wondered what she said about me when I left. It's important to wonder, Peter says, and it's important to know that we have a God of grace who calls us to live a life of Christ, to breathe in the truth of Christ in our life, and to be a witness to the world around us. Now, a second thing that Peter then gets into is not only do we have these challenges in our public arena, but we also have them in the private world in which we live as well. One of the things that's very clear about the history of the world is oftentimes the same systemic kinds of evils that get into civilization at a broad level can sometimes begin to dominate even some of the most intimate institutions of our private life, like family and marriage and relationships in the home. And Peter is concerned that when those things happen in the home, we once again respond to the love of God in our life and then demonstrate that love to others in the home as well. Before the first service, someone was saying, oh, you know, this means women are to submit to their husbands. And I said, yes, and it says that husbands in the same way are to submit to their wives. And then they said, well, it says that the woman is weaker. And I said, yes, that's the point. She's physically weaker and she's been oppressed in a system in so many ways, in so many relationships. Men need to realize that and treat them as a fellow heir of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amazing what he says about being a fellow heir. Do you know that the Jewish people in those days, many Jewish folks and rabbis taught that women couldn't go to heaven? They had to become a man first. So somehow God was going to, in the great day of visitation, change women into men, and then they would be saved and have a place. And Peter sees none of that. He says, husbands and wives are fellow heirs in Christ. But you know, family life can get murky. I know family life can get murky. There's pains and brokenness in so many places. I know in my own family, I went to Spokane to visit my sister. And I had sisters. I have sisters there. One of my sisters, I was with my sister standing in some murky water, literally in murky water. It was in a little stream outside of Spokane, Washington, and my four boys were playing in the water, and her four girls were playing in the water. And she called her girls and said, "Girls, it's time to go home." And they said, "Okay, can the boys come?" And she says, "No, those boys can't come." And I looked at her and I said, "What family are you from? How do you get off saying that? Did they do something wrong?" She said, "No." And I said, "Then what? What are you talking about?" And she goes, "Well," and she just fogged it. It's a very murky moment. And I felt that. My wife and I both felt it. And we felt it not just there, but over the years when we go back to Spokane. Kind of made me feel like I'd rather be in Hawaii. But we went, and we stayed engaged. And we just kept doing what the scriptures are calling us to do. And I'm not saying we were perfect at it, but I think we did pretty well with the Lord's help. Look at what it tells us to do in chapter 3, verse 8. Do you see it there? To sum up, all of you, do what? Be harmonious, sympathetic. Be brotherly, even if she's not being sisterly. Be kind-hearted and humble in spirit, not returning evil for evil or insult for insult, but giving a blessing instead. For you were called for this very purpose, that you might inherit a blessing. This was actually a key verse for us in responding to my sister. The whole book of Peter, 1 Peter was. My wife, in fact, took the first chapter of 1 Peter and put it on our refrigerator at home to be reminded of who we are in Christ. We're blessed, and because of the blessing that we have, we're called to give a blessing to others. And we just kept on seeking to do that with my sister. And it's actually a story of redemption, because several years ago, one of my boys decided to ride his bicycle across the country from New Jersey to Washington State and then down to San Diego. And we talked with him, and he really wanted to do this. He stopped in Spokane, Washington, and he visited all of his cousins. And I got a call from my sister, and she said, "You know, your boys are really wonderful kids. They're wonderful." And she said, "I don't know what's gotten into me over the years." She said, "I think maybe when you came riding into town in your white Suburban with your pretty wife and your four rambunctious boys, I think that maybe you displaced me as the queen bee in our family. And my girls stopped being the key princesses. And it threatened me." And I told her, "That's okay. No worries. I love you." That wasn't just me talking. That was the Lord talking through me. And it's really an attempt to seek to live out what Peter is saying. Of course, we're not always perfect. All of us fail. But it was our way of trying to realize we've been blessed, and so we're going to be a blessing to you, sweetheart. We're going to try to bless you. And you know, that's so much better a way to live. Have you ever been so angry at someone? So angry that you just wanted to curse them? That you just wanted bad for them? Oh, I just wish that they would be ill. Or I just wish that they would have their financial fortunes, you know, diminished. And yet, when we have those kinds of desires, what happens? You know, when they get sick, what happens? You catch what they have. When their stock goes down, well, they're invested in the same portfolio that you have, and it goes down as well. So be reminded, folks, Peter is telling us, that we are blessed and be a blessing. Now, he concludes the text today with a quote from King David. And King David was a person who was well aware of living in shark-infested waters. And he himself actually had become a shark a bit himself. He was guilty of murder, just as Moses had been. He was guilty of adultery. He was guilty of treachery on a public level in many different ways. And yet, one of the greatest fears that he had in life was that God would somehow turn God's face from him. And so in Psalm 34, he recognizes that we need to keep turning our face towards God, and our gracious God does turn God's face towards us. But David ends with this warning, and Peter ends with it too as he quotes David. If you look at the text, it tells us, Peter says, turn your face to the Lord, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. The reality is that we all do evil. Peter did evil. David did evil. Moses did evil. Abraham did evil. You do evil. I do evil. It's in us, around us, between us. But we can turn to a good shepherd and the guardian of our soul, because we are more than sharks. We have been called sheep, and he's the shepherd of his fold.
May the embrace of the Father be the comfort that you desire. May the name of the Son be the one on whom you rely. And may the presence of the Spirit be with you in every hour. May the three in one be the focus of all that you are and all that you do, now and forever. Amen.